1966, and his small wars are still part of armed forces in different parts of the world. It's still part of the curriculum. Small wars is a very important document for all counterinsurgency. And drawing on his experience in Second Afghan War and Boer War, and meant for British officials posted in Afghanistan and India, this book he points out that the history of small wars has shown that insurgents use hit and runs, striking boldly and then retreating quickly, and rarely engaging larger forces head on. Therefore, according to him, mere victory is not enough. The enemy, and please mark my word, the enemy must be thoroughly and utterly destroyed to the last man, woman, and child, which means enormous civilian casualties. The level of violence and barbarism, one would have believed that the democracies would be very sensitive to that heavy cost of incurring such civilian casualties, but we know from all the wars that we have seen, including Second World War, that the civilians were not spared. And as we see in Gaza, some people are even saying that it's not a war, it's worse than that, it's clear, and it's a situation of complete and utter barbarism that has been, it's kind of a Holocaust. It's been compared to what was done in Warsaw Ghetto during the Second War by the Nazis, where they used the argument of the insurgents amongst the Jewish, the Jewish partisans amongst the ghettoites, as an argument for attacking the ghettos, if you remember. And this is the same argument that the Israelis today use in Gaza, but saying that these people reside among the civilians, that the hospitals, the UN offices, etc., are actually where the insurgents are taking shelter. This is how the states delegitimize, legitimize their violence and delegitimize the rebels. They are robbed of the history, they are robbed of the context. So the Palestinians and the Gazans appear as in the Israeli discourse, in the American discourse, they appear as the ones who are to be blamed for firing rockets which affect the Israeli civilians. Decontextualized from the entire history of Palestinian struggle, what is happening in Gaza, the way in which the Gazans have been reduced to the kind of status. But remember, Colville, therefore, felt that the modern, one would have felt that, therefore, following Colville, one would have accepted that the modern democracies would have faced problem. And in India, post-47, for instance, that the government would be far more sensitive to civilian casualties. After all, we had freed ourselves from the British yoke, we were told, in 1947 when the power got transferred. So, they would have been greater, sensitivity displayed towards your own people, having suffered at the hands of the British Raj, having, you know, gone through an entire experience of what British colonial policy towards the movement for freedom was until 1947. But we didn't learn, and those wars carried on, and they were as brutal and barbaric. Just because they have not been recorded or documented adequately doesn't mean that therefore we are not obligated to return and understand what happened. Just like in Hyderabad, after the military operation, more than 200,000 Muslims are massacred, are allowed to be massacred by the Indian Army by encouraging the Hindu right-wing forces, especially RSS and all. Now it is excused by the very many of the Indian historians by saying that, well, this was in retaliation of what the Razakars had done in the previous era. That's not the point. The point is, once military established the control, the Indian Army did the same thing that the Sri Lankan Army carried out in Sri Lanka against the Tamils. There is a context. The war and its context are very important to understand. But what is even more important for understand is what lies behind war. Clausewitz said the war is continuation of politics as well as policy. Absolutely correct. So what politics and what policies are being carried out by these wars that the Indian state has fought against its own people? And what does it involve? Before I enter into why war, the government of India denies officially that there are any wars or armed conflict taking place in any part of the country. That all that is happening is police action. The Hyderabad operation was a police action. It was not an army military operation, it was a police action. By saying that it's a police action, we seem to reduce the impact which a military annexation would have. You know, if we are truthful intellectually, we would say it's a military annexation which took place. Whatever be the reason, I mean, in actual fact, it was a military annexation. Nizam's forces were defeated and the Indian army took over control of Hyderabad. So it was a military annexation. But no, it to bring it and make it, make people immune and probably unaware of what was actually carried out in the course of those wars, therefore, was lost on the people, and Indian intelligentsia and Indian scholarship is there. Phone, there is a big lacuna in analyzing the nature of the Indian state post 1947. This is even more interesting, friends, because if you realize one of the most important things in India that we face today, and we realize in the course of our struggle for civil liberties, is that in 1980s we began aware of these problems and started looking at Northeast, Manipur and other places and where Armed Forces Special Powers Act was in operation. We thought that it was only Armed Forces Special Powers Act that we had to deal with, and its mere repeal, that calling for its repeal would help bring about the kind of transformation or end the war or armed conflict in these areas. It's only in the later years that we realize that mere repeal of Armed Forces or Special Powers Act will not do. In fact, it's so deeply, legal immunity is deeply embedded in Indian law, and it draws its strength from Indian Constitution. That is the point that we have to be aware of, that we believe the Indian Constitution says equality before law, but in armed conflict areas of India, which the government of India denies that there are any armed conflict going on, the actual reality is that the people have been deprived of their rights. And what does the right, elementary right, mean? If a right in a bourgeois democracy is right to life, liberty and property, is a fundamental right, inalienable right also, according to the, in a bourgeois state, then it means that your recourse to a criminal court for redressal of a grievance, if you have suffered at the hands of the state forces, would that you would have access to that, right? In India, the actual condition in Jammu and Kashmir, Northeast India, Northeast of India, and as well as in nine states of India where the Operation Greenland is going on, that is not the case. So you have practically 136 districts out of 630 where equality of law doesn't exist, and in fact there is legal immunity provided to the security forces. Legal immunity simultaneously as citizens or people are denied the right of access to a criminal court by very simple stratagem. So even if Armed Forces Special Powers Act is removed for our Indian statute, the Army Act, and equivalent acts of paramilitary formation in India, which are called the Armed Forces of the Union by the Indian Constitution. Their charters, if you look at it and read it, and these materials are available on the website, so anybody can look at it. I've also written some on this issue. We'll show you that all these charters, in all these areas where armed conflict going on, it's the forces which have the right to decide whether they will refer the matter to a criminal court or to their own court-martial, in the case of army, or the general security forces court for the paramilitary forces. It's their right to decide. That is one. Second is, like Army Act 126 says, that the magistrate, a judicial magistrate, has a right to refer a matter to itself on its own recognition if it feels that there is a charge sheet to be made, and rather than the army, I want the hearing to take place in my courtroom. While that right is given, simultaneously it is said that in order for that magistrate then to carry on and begin the trial, you require the sanction of the central government, which is never in common. There is not a single instance where the government of India has sanctioned prosecution in any case where armed forces personnel have been implicated. Which means that there is no equality before law. So when we are talking about the Kashmiris, forget about their right to self-determination, which is a legitimate democratic right of theirs. Forget about that. Much before we can even enter the terrain, the basic fact is that these people are even denied equality before law. They are without any law, protection of law or hope. Now in this state, in such a